I'm going to describe exactly why three-phase power distribution is superior to single-phase power distribution systems and two-phase power distribution systems. We can imagine a three-phase turbine as a single magnet spinning underneath three different coils. The coils are placed 120 degrees apart. This causes three sine waves to appear at the three hot wires, each of them corresponding to a different circuit or a different coil. The sine waves wind up being 120 degrees out of phase with one another. In a three-phase power distribution system, we then have three different sine waves 120 degrees apart from one another, and then three neutral wires. The key benefit of three-phase power distribution systems is that the current's passing back through these three neutral wires sum to zero. Let me show you. We're going to model each one of these coils inside of a turbine as a voltage source, and we're going to give it a sine wave. The three sine waves are going to be 120 degrees out of phase with one another, but otherwise the sine waves are going to be equal to one another. We're going to assume that each of the three phases has the same resistive load, and we're going to call it R sub L. We're also going to assume that the three sine waves have equal amplitudes. So the only thing really different across these three phases here is the phase, 120 degrees apart from one another. Let's label the phases phase A, phase B, and phase C, and give them color codes. I'm calling the three black wires here in the middle, or the negative side of our turbines, neutrals. Let's go ahead and label our currents. In phase A, we have a current I sub A going out along the hot wire and then returning through the neutral wire. The same thing for phases B and C. Let's write the currents for each of those phases in terms of the voltage and the resistive load. We can just use Ohm's law, I equals V over R. There we have it for phase A, phase B, and phase C. Let's convert these to phasor forms so we don't have to worry about sine waves and time dependence. The numbers in parentheses are simply complex numbers written in polar form. Pocket calculators like these can very easily convert from polar to rectangular form. For example, for the first number, 1 angle of 0, I know that that's just 1. But the second number, I could key in 1 minus 120 degrees as an ordered pair in polar form and then use a pocket calculator like this to convert it to rectangular form. 1 at an angle of minus 120 degrees in rectangular form is minus 1/2 minus square root of 3 over 2 times j. We get something very similar for phase C. If you don't have a pocket calculator with you, you can also convert these manually. Let me remind you how to do that. We'll look at phase C for an example. We're going to be converting this number written in polar form into this number written in rectangular form. These are the same number, and they correspond to the same point on the complex plane. This is the real axis, and this is the imaginary axis. The number we're starting with has a radius of 1 sitting 120 degrees away from the real axis. Well, if this angle is 120 degrees, I know that this angle has to be 60 degrees. If I want to convert this number into rectangular form, what I'm really interested in knowing is this distance along the real axis and this vertical distance here in the imaginary direction. This distance here is the cosine of 60 degrees, which is 1/2. Because it's left of the origin, it's negative 1/2. That's why this number here is negative 1/2. This vertical distance here is the sine of 60 degrees. And you might recall that the sine of 60 degrees is the square root of 3 over 2. Now that we have expressions for the currents, I want to show you what's so special about three-phase power. We can see what's special if we combine the neutrals into a single common wire. In such a situation, we would then have four different currents flowing through this circuit. The three-phase currents, A, B, and C, and then the current flowing back through the neutral wire, I sub N. Let's go ahead and calculate I sub N. Using the Kirchhoff current law, I know that that neutral current has to be the sum of the three-phase currents. We can quickly see that the imaginary parts are going to add up to zero, but then the real parts add up to zero too. That means that the neutral current is zero. That's the advantage of three-phase power distribution. We don't need a neutral at all. I could just simply get rid of the neutral wire. Now, of course, all of this depends on everything being balanced. The amplitudes have to be the same in each of the three phases. the loads, the resistive loads, have to be the same as well. But assuming that you can maintain balance in your power network, then you don't need a neutral return wire. That saves a lot of copper. In the instance, for example, that the phases are not balanced, if one of the loads is a little bit more than one of the other loads, then you would have to have a neutral in place in order to maintain the same voltages. But the amount of current flowing through a neutral wire due to a phase imbalance turns out to be a lot less than the return currents would be if you didn't combine the neutrals together at all. In other words, if you have to have a neutral to handle situations of unbalanced loads, that wire doesn't have to be very thick because it wouldn't have to handle very many currents. When we connect the three load resistors together in this way, it's called a star load. Now there's another way to do it too, called a delta load, and I'll get to that in a moment. But when the three resistors come together into a single point, and that point is at the same ground or neutral voltage as the star point of our turbine, then we can call that a star connected load. Typically, these star points would also be connected to an earth. Although in this diagram, I've not shown the neutral wire connecting the turbine over to the load, of course, we could have that wire there. If we don't have the wire, then these three wires over here are called neutrals. The three wires over here are also called neutrals. If the load is balanced, then there wouldn't be a potential voltage from one neutral to the other. It's worth pointing out at this point, though, that although these three neutrals are nominally at 0 volts, that doesn't mean that a lot of current isn't flowing through them. In fact, the amount of current flowing through these three paths can be quite substantial. Neutrals can be dangerous, in other words. In order to get rid of the long neutral wire between the turbine and the star point of our load, the neutrals at the three loads must be connected and the loads must be balanced. Now, what do I mean when I say that the loads need to be balanced? If that resistor were a little bit lower or a little bit smaller than the other two resistors here in the star, it means that there would be less of a voltage drop across that resistor. It would cause the neutral point to float above the ground. The voltage drop across the two other resistors would increase. Normally, in a power distribution system, you want stable voltages. You don't want the voltage coming out of the wall to rise or fall if somebody in another building or another room plugs in something that's going to use up some of the power. Grounding the neutral point helps to stabilize the grid in that sense. Systems can normally handle a small amount of imbalance, but generally in a three-phase power distribution system, it makes a lot of sense to try to have equal current flowing through the three phases. This type of load connection, which I've called star, is also called a Y connection. If you rotate it a little bit, it looks a little bit like the letter Y. Sometimes Y is also spelled out as WYE. As I mentioned, quite often a neutral is also included, but not very much current would flow through that neutral. It just helps handle load imbalances. Let's now compare single phase, dual phase, and three-phase power distribution networks. The comparison metric I'm going to be using here is the ratio of copper needed to build out the network to the amount of power the network can deliver. A smaller ratio is better. When I talk about copper, by the way, I'm also referring to aluminum because quite a lot of the wires and cables used in our power network are made out of aluminum. So we're not only talking about copper here. Thicker wires are costlier than thinner wires, so it makes a lot of sense if we can somehow get the network to use as few wires as possible, or wires with a smaller diameter. And when we choose wires with a smaller diameter, we're actually restricting the maximum amount of current that such a wire can handle. A thin wire cannot handle as much current as a thick wire before it starts to get hot and burn up. So again, we're looking for a small ratio here because we want as few units of current as possible passing through the distribution system while simultaneously delivering a large amount of power. Let's compare this metric with each of the three systems here. We'll start with a single phase system. Our distribution system lines in between the two dotted lines here, and I see two wires, each carrying a current of I. So I can say that our comparison metric is going to be 2 units of current to 1 unit of power. I only have one resistor over here at the load. Our baseline case is 2. In a two-phase, three-wire system, we have a combined neutral. If the two sine waves were hypothetically in phase with one another, then I would write 2i down here. But because they're 90 degrees apart, only square root of 2i flows back through the neutral wire. This was calculated in my video on two-phase power. I see two resistors, both with voltage V, so we have 2 units of power delivered here. Our comparison metric here works out to 1.707. Let's move on to the three-phase case. We don't have a neutral at all, so I have 3 units of current flowing through the 3 hots, 0 units of current flowing back through the neutral, and I have 3 units of power delivered to the 3 different load resistors. Looking at these 3 numbers, I can see that 3-phase is best. It's the smallest number. Not only is 3-phase the best, it's theoretically the best possible case. For example, if I were to hypothetically have 5 phases or 6 phases or 12 phases, I would calculate a different ratio for sure, but adding more phases is not going to help the situation any further. By using 3 phases, we can maximize the amount of power delivered through our network while minimizing the cost of the wires and reducing the copper expense. That's the advantage of 3-phase. Whenever you see power lines outdoors, you often notice that they come in groups of 3s. This is evidence of the 3-phase nature, the 3-phase character of our power distribution system. This is true in all countries. They always tend to come in groups of 3. It also doesn't matter whether it's high voltage or low voltage. Everything tends to be 3 phases until you get almost to where the customer is located, and then you have a lot of single phase installations. For the very high voltage transmission lines, they're always 3-phase. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.